Glory in the highest heaven to the Father and the Son and the Spirit.
Post-tenebrous lux. After darkness, light. Before the Reformation, life in Europe was shrouded in darkness. The church of the day had made a serious mistake. They had reserved the Bible for clergy only. And if you close the book, you turn off the light. In that day, common men and women had limited personal access to the Word of God. And this meant that they relied solely on the church to tell them what the Bible says and means. Over centuries, those teachings fell further away from the truth and light of God's Word, leading its followers into a darkness as corruption ravaged the church. Imagine you're a poor peasant. A friar enters your town and cries, "As soon as the coin in the coffer rings, the soul from purgatory springs. The church has offered salvation for your dead father, daughter, brother, or wife. They will release their soul from the purifying flames of purgatory and admit them into heaven, all for a few coins." Or maybe you visit the sacred stairs and crawl each step on your knees, earning 1 year's forgiveness for each step that you climb. These are just a few of the practices that weren't found in Scripture that led one man to cry for reform. A German monk by the name of Martin Luther exemplifies the confusion of the day. If one could earn salvation through self-denial and suffering, it would have been this monk. He fasted from food and water for days on end, refused simple necessities like a blanket on a cold night. He prayed hard, he studied hard, and he worked hard, and still he lived in darkness. But then the light of the Word struck his heart. As he read the words of Scripture and compared it with the traditions of the church, Luther began to question the inconsistencies. These inconsistencies amounted to 95 theses or disagreements with the church, all which he wrote out and nailed to the door of the church, which was common practice of that day. In this, Luther intended to open a debate with the church leaders, but instead sparked the flame of reform within the church, beginning what years later historians would call the Reformation. Fast forward 4 years to 1521 and the Council of Worms. Luther has been formally kicked out of the church, but summoned to stand before them and recant his teaching that he had spread. Convinced of the gospel of Jesus Christ as laid out in Scripture, Luther proclaimed this: "Unless I'm convinced by Scripture and plain reason, I do not accept the authority of popes and councils, for they have contradicted each other. My conscience is captive to the Word of God. I cannot and I will not recant anything, for to go against conscience is neither right nor safe. God help me, amen." After being declared a heretic, friends of Luther kidnapped him and hid him for safety. And while Luther was frustrated by this, wanting to be home with his flock, he managed to translate the New Testament into German. The Bible was now open for the common man to read and interpret by the power of the Holy Spirit. The Reformation didn't end with Luther, but carried on to see the Bible translated into more languages and a new church movement that is our heritage as Protestants began. The light had been turned on in the vast darkness of Europe, and the truths of the gospel were available to all men. The truths preserved in the Reformation are laid out in what is called the five solas: sola scriptura, sola fide, sola gratia, sola Christus, and soli Deo gloria. In English, this means that salvation is found in Scripture alone, faith alone, grace alone, Christ alone, and to the glory of God alone. To deny any of these is to deny the true Christian faith. The Reformers stood up in their day, and they declared that the Word of God was their authority, not the church itself. Popes, councils, and culture had to take a back seat to Scripture. And this is the same decision that we must make as Christians today.
There we go. So the video I wanted to show, just to, it summed up kind of a lot of history that I didn't want to take the time to do. And if you haven't come to the conclusion already, this morning we will focus on remembering. It is the eve of the Reformation today. And so we will remember these great truths that were discovered, or rediscovered, I should say, for us. And, you know, as a pastor, it's October 31st, so I could have, you know, there was a temptation, well, let's talk about Halloween, you know, and just maybe a Christian perspective on Halloween, but this is much, much more important and much more a glorious topic and an encouraging topic for us to turn to. And you know what, just, you know, to say, it is somewhat of a shame, and I'm not an old, I'm not being old or grumpy or anything about this, because I know Halloween is, you know, who wouldn't love going door to door and getting candies or whatever. I do not find it a coincidence, however, that on a day where such, where we've set aside to remember that the light of God's truth and the glorious gospel of Jesus Christ burst onto the scene after a long time of darkness, is now totally eclipsed by a holiday that has nothing to do with him. And I think we can, you know, I'm not saying don't celebrate Halloween, that's up to you, but we should at least celebrate what happened some 500 years ago, because we are all sitting here as products of it. Let me just begin this morning by asking you some questions. What is your only hope in life and death? And why? Where does your peace come from? How do you, a sinner, stand before a holy God? What assurance do you have that you will be received into his presence? Do you this morning find joy in your faith? I want you to consider those questions. Like I've said, it's the eve of the Reformation, a time when the church remembers, again, the momentous struggle that took place over the gospel that eventually led to a division in the church. And we need to consider this, and the reason that we need to consider this is if we take seriously Jesus' words in the Gospel of John in chapter 17, he prays for the unity of his church. And if Jesus has prayed for the unity of the church, any division that has come into it needs to be considered very seriously. Very seriously. And we must, if Protestants and Roman Catholics today, this morning, still remain divided, we need to know why and understand it. Not because we want to engage in a fight. Not because we want to call each other's names. But for love of the truth, which is the only thing that can divide in the church. For the love of truth, we must know why. Because the differences that separated us 500 years ago remain the same today. Remain the same today. And the truth that was recaptured back then is still the glorious gospel today. And the truths that we are talking about get to the very heart of the gospel. And the gospel, if it's misunderstood, is not good news. So we need to understand it correctly. And so what happened 500 years ago is not an insignificant thing. It's tremendously important. And so this morning what I want to do is I want to take us into a little bit of what happened there. Remind us that there was a moment where God's truth was hidden, where it was lost. And that can happen, both literally and figuratively. We can lose God's word. And then I want to encourage us I want it to be encouraging for us. What I want you to do this morning as you leave the doors of this church is to be filled with joy and hope, even excitement over what you've received in Christ. Psalm 118, in verse 105, I'm taking it most of you have memorized that one. It's only 100 and something verses. So, verse 105, it says, "Your word is a lamp to my feet, a light to my path." When, like the video said, when we close this book, we lose the light. Right? When we walk apart from these words, we drift into darkness and confusion. And you might be thinking to yourself, how is it possible? How is it possible that we, the church, the community of God's people who have been entrusted with the Word of God, how could we possibly lose it? And we know that this happens. We even have an example of it in the Scripture. If you were to turn to 2 Kings chapter 22, you're going to read there about King Josiah. And King Josiah, in his 18th year, he decided that, you know, the temple of the Lord had been kind of allowed to just kind of waste away. It was in need of repairs. And so he takes this money that has been gathered and he said, now we've got to repair the temple. And so he sends the high priest to organize all this, Hilkiah. And Hilkiah goes and he's organized. So they're working on the temple. And the high priest, it says, Hilkiah, found the book of the law in the temple. He found it. And the book of the law at that time was the church's scriptures. At the very least, the first five books of Moses. If you found it, it means it was lost. It had been lost for some time. And Hilkiah wasn't, the passage doesn't indicate Hilkiah was looking for it. He stumbled upon it. He hadn't even realized it had been lost. And once they found it, they realized what it was. It says King Josiah read it, and he read about all that God had promised and all that God had commanded them, and he realized that they were not obeying it. So he broke down and he wept, and he commanded that the people gather for the reading of the Lord's word. The book had been closed. The knowledge of the Lord had been obscured. So this does happen. In 1 Timothy, Paul writes to the young pastor Timothy, and he encourages him to pay attention to his teaching, pay attention to his doctrine, and closely protect the truth. And in verse 14, he says this, "By the Holy Spirit who dwells within us, guard the good deposit entrusted to you." Other translations say, guard the treasure that has been entrusted to you. The job, one of the jobs of the church is to protect the treasure entrusted to us in the gospel, to guard it, to protect it, to not neglect it, to not let it fall by the wayside and just become something on the side that gets obscured. Kind of lost in plain sight, right? Sometimes that just happens as we neglect things. I was watching a movie a few months ago called The Dig. Maybe you've seen it. It's a pretty good movie. I would recommend it. But it's based on a true story of just on the eve of World War II in England. I won't get into all the details, but this wealthy land, well, I shouldn't say wealthy, this landowner has vast amounts of land, and on her land are these mounds. And she has an inkling there's something there, that they're just not natural kind of mounds. They're covered in grass or whatever and whatnot. So she hires an archaeologist, Basil Brown, and he's really a nobody in the archaeological world. He dropped out of school at age 12 and he's self-taught, but he comes and looks at her field and he believes, yeah, I think there's something here. And the rest of the archaeological world said, no, these are just hills. And he starts to excavate them, and what does he find? He finds there Anglo-Saxon ships, a ship of a king there. It was a burial ground for a king. And it had been just laying there in the open. And over time, it had been covered by dirt and, you know, the wind and whatever, and then the mounds built and the grass grew, and it was just right there in plain sight, but hidden. The church in the 15th century was at a point where, after a long period of time, it had adopted many false practices that had piled up on God's truth and hid it. Church services were in Latin, so they're not the common, you know, you come here and we talk in English, I preach to you in English. Back then, it would have been all in Latin, no matter what language you spoke. Sermons were uncommon. The Lord's Supper and the celebration of it was in Latin, and then only the bread would be given to people because if they thought that it, because of the idea that the bread and the wine turned into the real flesh and body of Christ, they couldn't give the wine to the people in case it spilt on the floor. Corrupt practices, like the video had said, selling of indulgences became common. So you could buy dead relatives out of purgatory, out of time in purgatory. You could earn merit towards your salvation. All of these things piled up to hide the truth. But what was most devastating and just most, what was the worst of the corruption was the system of salvation that developed. How salvation was understood, because it robbed the gospel of grace, and it distorted it. And the gospel is announcing a message to us, and that message is about how a guilty sinner can be righteous and stand before God morally right and justified, right? Stand before God justified, not guilty. Romans chapter 1, verse 17 says, the righteous shall live by faith. That got hidden. The biblical truth that a person is saved by grace alone, justified by faith in Christ, was distorted. And that distortion, the system of salvation that was developed through that period, the distortion remains today, and that's why a division remains today. And so I want to throw up a short video here that just it visually represents or explains this the idea that had developed and remains today. And so, can you just pause it to make sure the volume's up? Maybe restart it just so we can hear it. It's quite poor. No, this is the wrong video. The other one, please. Yeah.
In the Roman Catholic plan of salvation, baptism cleanses an infant from original sin.
And that is the sacrament of regeneration as well as justification.
That it starts them off on this plan. On this track. Along the way, however, they can commit these small sins, venial sins, which plunges them back down, and heaven forbid they commit a mortal sin, which knocks them completely off the plan of salvation.
And he must now receive sacraments. He must confess his sins to a priest, which is the sacrament of penance. And then he must be re-justified by doing good works, by doing penance. And once he is re-justified, then he must maintain his salvation through sacraments.
And if, in the end, if they have enough people praying for them, and if they do enough time in purgatory, they might possibly get to heaven.
How they get to heaven is based on what they do rather than what Christ has done.
That is kind of an illustrated, I hope that helps understand what the teaching is. Now, upon watching that, some of you may realize that that's pretty close to what I think. I kind of consider my salvation in that way. I would argue that illustrates how most mankind kind of defaults to that position. I must do something. I must be involved in some way to obtain my salvation. I must be involved in making myself righteous before God. So how do I get righteous before God? Well, there's a combination of God's grace and my good works. And one of the things I want you to understand this morning is in this system, as you saw, you're filled with justifying grace. And I know those sound technical, just hang with me and they'll become clear. You're filled with grace. It's like grace is like a substance that's poured into you, making you righteous and perfect before God. And then as you sin, that kind of gets, it spills out. And then you've got to do good works to kind of fill it back up. And that's required to establish your justification, your right standing before God. And so what emerges in this system, again, is a mixture of God's grace and your works. And that provides your salvation. And like I said, many, many people think this way. Not just Roman Catholics, but Protestants too. We have this idea that this is what the Bible teaches. The problem is when you think about the system like this, there's no real, it doesn't offer any true peace. No real comfort for you. It doesn't seem to describe what Jesus says to lost sinners in Matthew, does it? When Jesus says, "Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls." In Jesus, we're to find rest. Our salvation is to come with rest for our souls. This message that we've just seen, this doesn't offer you rest. You're at work, trying to justify yourself. This morning, as you sit here this morning, do you feel at rest in your soul? Is Jesus' yoke light for you? Or do you feel like you're carrying a heavy burden, that you're not sure of your salvation, that you find yourself tormented by a sense of your guilt, that you ask the question, am I good enough? How can God accept me? Thinking that God is constantly putting his heavy hand upon you or casting you out because of the sins that you may have fallen in. During the period of the Reformation, scholars like John Huss and William Tyndale, Martin Luther were, like the video said, opening up the Bible and beginning to read it and finding out that the church's teaching were not describing what the Bible was saying, what they were reading in the pages of Scripture. Where was this rest for their souls? They were encountering verses in Romans and Galatians and things that we're saying, right? Romans 8:1, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Or Romans 5:1, we have been justified by faith. We have peace with God because of what Jesus has done. So these passages that they're encountering don't seem like, again, they're not lining up with what's being taught. They're reading passages like Titus 3, verses 4 to 7. I should have told you to turn there before, but it's okay. You can just listen. If you want, you can turn to Titus 3, 4 to 7. In this passage is just, it's a wonderful passage. Paul summarizes in such clear terms the gospel and how we receive it. I want to read it to us. Because you think of this system and you read this and you can see the difference. And I know we're just jumping in right in the middle of what Paul is saying, but Paul has come to a point here in Titus where he's been encouraging the Christians there to, you know, to live at peace with those around them, the unbelievers around them. And he says, do this and show them grace because of what God has shown you, the goodness God has shown you. And then he sums up their salvation and he says this: but when the goodness and loving kindness of God our Savior appeared, He saved us. Not because of works done by us in righteousness, but according to His own mercy. By the washing of regeneration and renewal of the Holy Spirit, whom He poured out on us richly through Jesus Christ our Savior, so that being justified by His grace, we might become heirs according to the hope of eternal life. Amen? Those are wonderful, grace-filled, rich verses. And what's the one thing, as you read this passage, what's the one thing that jumps out at you? It's all God's work. You read it, it's because of His love. His love and goodness is shown to us. Because He sent His Son. Right? It's through Christ, our Savior, His death, His resurrection. It's because of His mercy that you're saved. And notice, Paul talks about not just how our salvation is, how He saved us, but now how He applies it to us. And he says that it's applied to us by the Spirit, His Spirit who has been poured out on us. Right? His Spirit is poured out on us, and there's regeneration and renewal that takes place. And what that word regeneration means there, it's just a way of describing that through the Holy Spirit, your hard heart, your rocky hard heart has been replaced. He's given you a new heart, a heart of flesh that responds to Him. And He's washed us. He's cleansed and justified us by His grace. This is all God's work. You and I in this passage, the only thing that it says about you and I is that our good works are definitely not the basis of our salvation. Not the basis of our salvation. But we are recipients of all of Jesus' work. Right? We are like the rusty barn, the old broken rusty barn. And God comes along and He patches everything up. He sands down all the exterior, all the rough, gross, rotten stuff. He sands it all down, and then He buys the paint and He shakes the paint can, and then He gets home and He gives it another stir, and then He paints it all. We're just the barn. And then in that last part, He says, so that you may be justified by His grace. That grace. Right? That's how you stand righteous before God, is not guilty by His grace. Right? So the reformers are reading this. We are reading this. And then you read other passages like Ephesians 2, 8 and 9. For by grace you have been saved through faith. This is not of your own doing. It is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. We are not saved by our good works, but by God's grace. We have been justified by faith, and therefore we have peace with God. Right? In the other system, our good works were involved. They were involved and needed for you to be justified. And so when we say here, and when Paul says that you are justified not by works but by faith, what does he mean? What does it mean to say that you are justified by faith? It means this, that you stand righteous before God by trusting in his mercy, believing that he has provided everything for your salvation in Jesus Christ. Being justified by faith means you stand righteous before God, trusting in his mercy and believing that he's provided everything for you in Jesus Christ. Because when we believe in Christ, God credits all of Christ's righteousness to us. So our status changes. We're still sinners, but we are considered and declared righteous. This is what is the difference between this and what we saw in the video? Let me try and illustrate it. The first, what we saw first was this. If you were walking along in your life and you came to a point where you heard the gospel and you responded to it, it's like you've been given a bowl. Now you're holding a bowl and God fills it with the liquid of grace and you stand before him. Because it's full of grace, you stand before him righteous and perfect. And so now you start to live and you're walking along the path of life, and of course you're going to hit a bump. You're going to stumble in sin, so you're going to move along, and that liquid in that bowl is going to start to fall out. Right? You're going to start to lose some of it. And so then you go, I've got to get that liquid up to the point where I'm justified still before God. So I got to do some good works. And so you carry on through life. Now the thing is, you don't know along that path when you're walking and stumbling and you're spilling that death is going to come, because death comes to all of us. And if death comes at some point where that liquid is a little too low, then you've got an issue. Because you don't know if you're in or out of salvation at that point. Now, on the other hand, the other way, the way that is described here by Paul, it's as if you hear the gospel of Jesus Christ and you put your faith in him. God doesn't give you a bowl with liquid, but he gives you a blanket of Christ's righteousness, which he wraps around you. And now you're walking through life, and you're going to trip and stumble. You're going to fall in sin. But when you fall, you don't lose part of the blanket. You get back up, and you continue walking. It covers you. And when death comes, you're fully righteous. You're fully justified to stand before him, cloaked in the righteousness of Christ. They're two radically different views, aren't they? Radically different views. One is filled with light and life and comfort, and the other is filled with heavy burden, where we are never sure of our salvation. The Bible teaches we're justified by faith, not by works. Right? It's not a substance that's poured into you that you may lose, but it is a declaration made about you. A sure and a certain act of God where he declares you righteous in his sight. Justification declares you righteous. Now, some of you might be asking, well, what's the role of works? And the works are absolutely important and necessary. You are saved by grace. You're justified by faith. And the product of that now are good works to the glory of God. They do not justify you. They do not save you. They're a product of the grace that you've received in your salvation. And now I want to show you just one more clip, and I know it's video heavy here, to explain this the biblical view of salvation. And Richard, I'll get you to throw that on now, please.
The Bible teaches there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ. That when you put your faith in Jesus Christ, the work has been done. He saves you totally, completely, perfectly. And even though, yes, we sin and can repent, the sacrifice of Christ has paid for those sins. And so there is assurance that he has saved you, he has plucked you out of the world, you're in the palm of his hand, and nobody can pluck you out of his hand.
That's a much more comforting view, isn't it? That's the biblical view. This is the gospel which redeems sinners. Right, who redeems sinners who have had a heavy yoke of sin and guilt upon them. This is the gospel that removes that burden and replaces it with joy and peace and comfort and hope and rest. When we ask ourselves that question, what is our only hope in life and death? The resounding answer is Jesus Christ, our all-sufficient Savior. He provides salvation for us. He gives us that real peace, the true comfort, the joy and the assurance that he's accomplished it for us and that we will be received into God's presence. When you lay your head at the end of the night, at the end of a night, maybe a hard day, when you lay your head on the pillow and there's those times when you ask yourself those questions, Lord, how can you love me? I can't believe I did that today. And you know, the burden of sin comes upon you and you start to ask those questions. Turn your eyes to Christ. And remember, picture that blanket that you're under, that Christ's righteousness has been given to you. It covers you. And let that comfort you. You have been justified by faith. And so you have peace with God. You have peace with God. Church family, let that resound in your heart. Let it rest there and remind you daily. God will never leave or forsake you. He will not cast you out of his presence. By his mercy, he has saved you. You are his child. He has adopted you. Let that fill you with a joy. One of Luther's 95 theses, and I end on this, simply declares, the true treasure of the church is the most holy gospel of the glory and grace of God. It is a treasure to cherish and to guard. The church has lost sight of this. And there's always a danger that the church will lose sight of this. It happened 500 some odd years ago. And if we don't remind ourselves and look at the scripture, it can happen again. We don't want that to happen. And so by reminding ourselves of this message, it keeps us from clutter being built up upon this book. It opens it to us, and we can rest assured in God's grace and our salvation. And it's through the remembering what happened 500 years ago that we're reminded that the only authority for us in our faith and our practice is the Scripture alone. And that we discover our salvation is by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone, to the glory of God alone. Amen? Okay. I'll invite Dallas and the Kott family and Diana to come up here. She's going to play drums now, and we're going to praise the Lord for his, for our great salvation.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Here below, praise Him.